And then
Sir, this is just to confirm, like the midsum will be on 24th.
Yeah, in the typical during the, I mean, I think morning session they have given, right?
Sir, 1:30, I think.
Huh?
Afternoon session, sir.
Afternoon session, 1:30.
Okay. Afternoon session, fine. I mean, that's on Thursday, right?
Wednesday,
okay.
Yeah,
I requested for Thursday, but anyway, I have no problem. But I hope, I mean, none of you have any cross. Yeah, same thing, same time. Yeah,
thank you, sir.
Okay. So, I'll give some practice problem, so that and you can expect, I will take similar problem, but I will twist it for the exam so that, you know, you should be able to solve those with the chain, I mean, with the whatever you have learned from the class. Okay. But I will give you some practice problem. Okay.
It will be written, no sir, like.
Yeah. Just basic, simple written exam. Then you take a photo, take a PDF, and upload it. So I'll in the module. Okay. So write it in a fresh white paper, one side of the white paper. Okay. And then take a photo and save it as a PDF or JPEG file and upload it.
Thank you, sir. And like the duration,
My guess is it should not take more than 2-2.5 hours, but I'll give full 3 hours to complete and plus some time for upload.
Okay.
Typically, students don't take my exam to finish within more than 2-2.5 hours, but I don't mind giving you extra time because I don't want you to, like, you know, stress and all these things. Take your time, finish the work. Okay, so today I'm going to start a Bayesian Monte Carlo simulation with R. So the major topic that I'm going to cover in this module are introduction and motivation to Monte Carlo simulation that is required for Bayesian inference. I have given you some motivation in the last lecture. And then some most simplest form of the Monte Carlo simulation is called inverse transform method, typically for one-dimensional distributions. Then acceptance rejection method. And so inverse transform method is the most simplest. And then in order to, but it has certain limitations to it. Overcome the limitation, we will study the acceptance rejection. We will see that there is an improvement, but also at the same time, acceptance rejection also has its limitations. Once, and then in order to overcome that limitations, we will study the important sampling method. When we will realize that, okay, even that has its own limitations, we will study the Markov chain Monte Carlo method. In that, particularly two algorithms, the most popular one. One is the Gibbs sampler, another is the Metropolis-Hastings. And finally, I'll do some MCMC diagnostics. And then I'll do a separate module on how you can implement R STAN package. STAN is a standalone software, I would say rather. It's written in C in this package, free pack, open G under GNU license. And it has R interface, Python interface as well. So either you can run it from Python or R. So I will show you with the R because my all legacy codes are on R. So in the next lecture, once this module ends, I'll do a separate, complete separate module on R with Stan. And R with Stan is a very, once you see that there is a some degree of cumbersomeness and implementation of Markov chain Monte Carlo is a nightmare for analysts. So most of the Gibbs sampler, most of the Bayesian statistics, statistical package which implement the Bayesian methods, they give a Monte Carlo simulator for specific model, model specific simulator for regression, for logistic regression, for, you know, new, any like, you know, standard known models. But if you want to, if your problem is very different and you want to develop your own new model, and that model does not fit into any of this standard regression, logistic regression kind of model, then you have to write your own Monte Carlo simulation technique, which is a very difficult method in a sense. Monte Carlo method are like, you know, so in order to solve that problem, the Stan was developed. The way Stan is developed, you just give your data model or the likelihood model, you give your prior model and you run it, and basically it will just simulate the data from, simulate the parameters from the posterior distributions. And it is fairly stable even for a reasonably high dimension models. So, and it is definitely, and it use something called quantum Monte Carlo methods or hybrid Monte Carlo methods to do the really high dimensional, solve the really high dimensional integration problem. So hybrid Monte Carlo or the quantum Monte Carlo is the new generation version of the Markov chain Monte Carlo. If Markov chain Monte Carlo is, then, you know, from the last century, then people say that hybrid or the quantum Monte Carlo from this century. So that will be, I will do a completely separate module. So let us start with the introduction and motivation. So suppose Y is my data, which has a model P of Y given theta, and P of theta is the prior distribution over theta. So our objective is to make a statistical inference about the theta. That is our objective. So first what we do, so given the likelihood model and given the prior distribution model, we first write down the posterior distribution. What is that? Posterior distribution is P theta given Y equal to PY given theta times P theta integration of this thing. And that plays as a normalizing constant, the denominator. Then what we do, just having the posterior distribution is not enough. We have to say what is the expected value of theta as a function of data. So expected value of theta given the data will be some function of theta. So how we can do that? You integrate the theta times P theta given Y times D theta. So you take the posterior mean of the posterior distribution. You calculate the posterior mean of the posterior distribution. That will give you the expected value of theta given the data. Similarly, you can compute posterior median, then other inferences, you can compute posterior variance, posterior standard deviation, everything. Posterior mode turns out to be an optimization problem, which we have fairly good idea about how to do optimization. But other than posterior mode, pretty much all other inferences turns out to be solving an integration problem in Bayesian inference. So therefore, we will concentrate on how to solve an integration problem. So now our Bayesian inference problem boils down to solving an integration problem. Most often it is a high dimension integration problem. So in order to get the posterior mean, as we have to solve this integration, analytical solution has not exist. So we resort to this simulation technique, and this simulation technique is often called Monte Carlo integration. So what is the main crux of the Monte Carlo methods? Philosophically, Monte Carlo methods or Monte Carlo simulation relies on possibility of generating endless flow of random variables. I have a computer, I have a computing machine, which will be able to simulate as many random variables as we want. Thousands or millions or billions or trillions, as many ones it should be able to generate for well-known or new distribution. Doesn't matter if it is a well-known distribution, well, good. If it is not so well-known distribution, even it then also it should be able to simulate the random variables from that distribution. Such simulation is based on the generation of uniform random variable on an interval of 0, 1. And we are not concerned with the detail of producing how you simulate from uniform random numbers. That's a different ball game altogether. Simulation of random number itself is a big area in the computer science. And I am not going to talk about it. I'm saying that, okay, I have a computer, I have a method, I have algorithm, that computer package, which gives me the uniform, which has a uniform random generator, which gives me uniform random variable between 0 and 1. Okay. Typically, if you just do a little bit of Google search, all these random number generators are not actually true random number generators. They have a nickname called pseudo random number generators, because it has certain mathematical properties which basically tells us that you will never be able to generate true random numbers from the machine. But what they do, they generate some samples and then they try to do certain check the properties of those simulated random samples and make sure those samples are coming from the uniform 0, 1. That is their main goal. Okay. But here we will always assume that we have a random number generators between 0, 1, and we are going to use that, left, right, and center. So we want to estimate the posterior mean. So this is my target. So what we will do, I'm going to simulate lots and lots of random numbers from P theta given Y, the posterior distribution theta given Y. Suppose theta 1, theta 2, theta capital N are the random samples from P theta given Y. If that is so, then I can approximate G of Y by G hat of Y by taking 1 by N summation of these simulated numbers. And then we have to ensure one thing, that these simple random samples, these are all simple random samples. If I can just ensure that these are all simple random samples or IID random samples, then laws of large number will kick in and this G hat will converge to G of Y. As N tends to infinity, N is my simulation size. Now, how many simulation I will do, that will depend on my computing ability. If I have a very large computer, I will be able to do a lot of simulation. If I do not have large computer, so I have to little bit I have to do take some degree of Monte Carlo error. So, and this is the main crux of Monte Carlo simulation. So my target is to estimate mean. What I do or integration, I write down the integration problem. I can see this, I can write, think of that, this is my f of theta d theta. This is my problem. And then what I can write down this f of theta d theta as theta times p of theta, where p of theta is a random probability distribution function. Then what I do, I just simulate from this probability distribution function and take the average of that. And that average, I'm just hoping that as the simulation size increases, that average will converge to the true value of the integration problem, to the true solution. And that's how it is being solved. So now why only stop at t of theta of s? I can take any function, h of theta I, h is a one-to-one function. If I just ensure h is a one-to-one function, then as n goes to infinity, my simulation goes to infinity, this sample mean converges to e of h theta given y, which is integration h of theta p theta given y. Now h of theta, that means I can take y only, just simple theta. I can take variance, I can take higher order moments, I can take anything I want, as long as it's a, you know, a smooth function, some sort of smooth function. Now, here is a interesting slight detour, I would say. I can say that due to central limit theorem, this h bar minus expected the mean divided by this sigma n square. My sigma n square is simply sample variance in this case, such will converge to normal 0, 1. The central limit theorem will kick in as long as the second moment of h of theta square is the second moment of h of theta is finite, is integrable. If that is finite, that means this sigma square is finite. So sigma n square will converge to sigma square. So that means my this distribution or this quantity will converge to zero, normal distribution with 0, 1 or standard normal distribution. Now, what this result tells us? This result actually tells us that advantage of CLT is we can evaluate the Monte Carlo error. So that means if I can ensure this is integrable, then I can estimate the Monte Carlo error. So it assumes the sigma n squared is a proper estimate of the variance of h n bar. So h bar I'm trying to calculate, and how much every time I will run the thing, you will run the simulation, you will see that your estimate is slightly different, because every time you are running a different simulation, it's a random numbers generator, right? So how much actually it is deviating from your target solution, that Monte Carlo estimates, you can get a Monte Carlo error, and sigma n square is a reasonable fair assessment of the possible Monte Carlo error. And another property that Inch tells us that if sigma n squared does not converge, it might happen that h theta square p theta d theta is not finite. That means your sigma n squared does not converge. But still integration h theta p theta d theta is finite. You may end up in that kind of scenario. In that case, what will happen? Your h bar will converge to the target mean, but it will be very slow. Your Monte Carlo error will be too high, and it will be not a very efficient Monte Carlo simulator. Up to this, all of you have the idea. This is the crux of philosophy of the Monte Carlo simulation and how we solve integration problem. Okay.
In such cases, like where the second movement does not converge, first movement converges. If we have a very, very high sample size, can we be sure?
No.
Okay.
No. Even high sample size also will not ensure. See, sample size is different story. Here, simulation size is the main thing. Because your data is constant. Even if you have lost a lot of samples, it doesn't matter. Your entire story is on the edge of the integrability of the h theta squared p theta given y. Even if you have a lot of samples, this guy will have a different variability. The theta will have a different variability. I mean, but whether we are more interested in the whether it is the second moment is integrable or not. And we are interested in the more on the theta 1 to theta n. We are not interested in the y1 to yn. Your y may be y1 to y small n, right? So in your data set, capital Y may be y equal y1, y2, y small n. Small n is not going to affect. So n is constant. So that is not going to affect. What is given that y1 to y small n, I am trying to estimate this posterior mean. I can have a lot of simulation size. I mean, I can lot of simulations. I can in huge simulation size, few millions maybe. But if my higher order moments are not integrable, but some reason first order moment is integrable, then I will have a posterior mean. My Monte Carlo simulator will be able to estimate it, but the Monte Carlo error will be very high. So in that case, it is better. I mean, you have to be a bit careful. That's what I'm trying to say. But these are very rare cases, rarest of the rare cases, actually. Just I just give you the sense of, basically what is the right way of saying it. It's a corner of the theory, basically, or some corner of the main theory. But main crux is, the main beauty of how you solve this integration is you simulate from this posterior distribution, take the average. And this idea is basically you can solve it for any integration problem. It has nothing to do with actually probability theory. Okay. All you have to do, you just think about if theta times p theta given y as a function of theta. It could be any function. Not necessarily it will be a PDF or any PMF or anything. It could be any continuous function on which you want to do an integration. All you have to do, you have to write it down into two parts, g theta and p theta, and make sure p theta is a distribution, a proper probability distribution. And then, and I will talk about it, how people really do these things. Okay. So then what you can do is you can simulate from P theta and theta one, theta two, theta n, and you take the average of those theta and you hope that your law of large number will kick in and your sample estimate will converge to the true solution. So that is the main crux. So this is a direct application of law of large number that you are saying to solve the integration problem.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. So this is the real beauty part. And I'm just giving here, it's just a corner side of the theory, actually. All right. Using the random number generator in R. In R package, it has, in R software, you have large number of statistical functions which generate random samples from standard distributions. Similar packages and modules are available in Python also. Typically, at least one dimension random number generator for one, one dimension probability distribution. Lots of packages are available. If built-in functions in R is available, then we can use it directly to simulate from that distribution. If I know that my posterior distribution has is a gamma distribution or normal distribution or log normal distribution, standard distribution, I can just directly simulate from that distribution and I'm done. If the built-in functions are not available and the posterior is known up to a kernel, that means the normalizing constant are not available, then we have to use some generic method to draw sample from such distribution. Okay, so first algorithm that we are going to talk about called inverse transform method. So what is the inverse transform method? So the probability integral transform allows us to transform uniform into any random number. Okay, so there is a result, it's called if X has a density function small f, so f is the PDF and the CDF is capital FX, then we have this relation. So f of X equal to minus infinity to X, f of u du, okay? So capital F of X is my cumulative density function and small f of u is the probability density function of the random variable X. So this is my first day of probability theory. Now, there is a result where you can show f of X CDF follow uniform 0, 1. Do you know this result? Is it being taught in your class? Hello.
Like it was taught then in like introductory probability class, but I have seen it in my bachelor's.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Same here. I've seen it in my bachelor's, but.
But in your probability statistics with our class, it's not.
No.
No, okay. Sir.
Okay. So that means the people who have from math stat background, they probably have seen this result, but people who are from the engineering and other background, they may not have seen this result. So I will assign it as maybe a practice problem. This is actually a simple, it's very easy to prove, but that will be a significant detour from today's discussion. And what I will ask you the class to consider it as a standard proven result, okay? And use this result to develop our next level of theory. But you can prove it, very easy to prove. It's 2-3 lines proof. In fact, if you do Google search, probably you will get the solution also, okay? So, but I will assign it in the practice problem. So we said what we do, we want to simulate from basically f of x. Remember that we want to simulate x. We do know f of x. So what we can do, we can write u equal to f of x and solve for x. So suppose x is follow exponential distribution with rate parameter equal to 1. Now, I know the CDF, the cumulative distribution function for exponential distribution with rate parameter lambda equal to 1 is 1 minus e to the power minus x. So if I just solve for it, so for x, then what I will do, I will just write, I will put u, if in place of f of x, I'll write it as a u equal to 1 minus e to the power minus x. And I'll, if you just do the algebra, you can see, you can rewrite this equation as x equal to minus log of 1 minus u. Now, what is this relationship tells me? Now remember that f of x follow uniform 0, 1. So that means basically tells me if of in irrespective of the distribution, underlying distribution, if X is a random variable, if X is a random variable, it has a distribution, then F of X, I can say that F is a one-to-one function, and F of X is also a random variable. Irrespective of the what the distribution of X, U, the distribution of U will be always uniform 0, 1. So I can simulate from uniform 0, 1 and plug it in this transformation. So I will get the value of X and I will say that, hey, I got a X which actually follow exponential distribution with lambda equal to 1, rate parameter lambda equal to 1. So what I have done to check this theory, I said that, okay, I have decided I will take a simulation size of 1000. I will simulate 1000 samples from exponential. So first I have simulated from uniform distribution. R unif is a built-in function in R, which is going to simulate from n samples from between the unit interval 0 to 1. And then, here is a small mistake. Yeah. So then I have to write X equal to log of 1 minus U. And that gives me the X here. This X supposed to follow exponential distribution with lambda equal to 1. Then what I have done, I have said that, okay, maybe, I don't know whether my simulated numbers are doing well or not. Built-in R functions I can trust because it has been, you know, in use for a long time. If many people have used these generators. This REXP is a generator which people are using for a long time. I know this REXP function is there for a long time, probably for last 20 years. And people do use for simulating from exponential distribution. So I'm going to use n samples from exponential distribution with lambda equal to 1. So y will be a vector of sample n, which I'm going to use built-in function of R, and X is our own algorithm. And then what I'm going to do, I'm just going to draw a histogram X and Y, and I'm going to do a Kolmogorov-Smirnov test between X and Y to check if these two samples have the same distribution or different distribution. So when I did that, so what Kolmogorov-Smirnov test tells us? The Kolmogorov-Smirnov test null hypothesis says that X and Y coming from the same distribution. Alternate says X, Y are not coming from the same distribution. So p-value is quite high. So we cannot reject the null hypothesis. So most likely X and Y coming from the same distribution. Also, I did a histogram. So it looks like they are coming from the similar distributions. So this is a really simple example of how this distribution works. Okay. Now, what other inverse transform functions are there? Logistic CDF is one distribution, or logistic distribution is one distribution whose CDF is available in mathematically closed form solution. Now, if you take mu equal to 0 and lambda equal to 1 here, what you get is 1 equal to 1 by 1 plus e to the power minus x, right? So, which is known as a logit function, right? Or sigmoid function. So, what we know as logit function or sigmoid function is actually a special case of CDF of logistic distribution. Here is another CDF, very popular CDF from Cauchy distribution, for the CDF of the Cauchy distribution. Okay, half of 1 by pi tan inverse x minus mu by sigma. Okay, so you can use these transformations to simulate from logistic distribution and Cauchy distribution, and then you do a Kolmogorov-Smirnov, and also there are built-in functions which in R which can help you to simulate from Cauchy and logistic, and you can do a Kolmogorov-Smirnov test to check whether this inverse transform method does work, and you can use it for your for those functions, simulation functions later as well.
So how do the built-in methods simulate?
To be honest, I don't know. I have to check in their methodology. Most likely this is the method, unless the transformation is cumbersome and computationally expensive. Okay. Most likely this is the method. I really don't know. I have to check their manual and all these things. What is the methodology? There could be like, you know, three different algorithms which actually simulate from, say, exponential, okay? Then, but built-in function will implement the one which has the best time complexity, correct? So, I don't know which one has the best time complexities. This is just a basic intro to the inverse transformation method. Okay.
Yeah, I was just asking because I thought they would be using this itself.
Maybe. I don't know. But there could be alternate algorithms also. There are alternate algorithms also. And you will see that there are actually a lot of all other alternate algorithms. So actually, I don't know which one they are using. Okay. Yes. So some general transformation methods there are which we can use, and these are actually the results. Probably the people from statistics honors background have seen it, or math honors background from seen it, but the other backgrounds won't seen it. So don't worry about it. These are like, you know, basic thing. We will use this result. We are not going to prove this result, okay? So if xi are iid samples from exponential distribution with lambda equal to 1, these are the standard distribution you can derive. Mathematically, you can derive that 2 of summation xi follow chi square 2n, then beta summation xi follow gamma n beta, then summation xi by summation I from 1 to I runs from 1 to n, and the denominator runs from 1 to n1 plus n2 will follow beta distribution from n1 comma n2. So now I know how to simulate from exponential. So now I can write a function which will help me to simulate from chi squared distribution of 2 n degrees of freedom, or gamma distribution with n comma beta, or beta distribution with n1 and n2. So I can use these functions, use this result to simulate from these distributions also. So these are called general transform methods. So if you know how to simulate from one distribution, and you know that if you can do some operations on those distributions and get another random variable, and if you know that that random variable follow popular distribution, like here, y follow popular distribution gamma n comma beta. Then if I can easily simulate from gamma n comma beta. Now, these transformations are quite simple and we will use them quite often, okay? But however, there is a limit to their usefulness. Only when the closed form cumulative distribution functions are available, the method is available to use. You can use this method. The method will not work for a Gaussian distribution, because CDF or the cumulative distribution function for Gaussian distribution is not available in closed form. So if I want to simulate from Gaussian distribution, I will not be able to use a simple inverse transform method or a general inverse transform method. This inverse transform method for sure, I'll not be able to use. But this is another result, something called Box-Muller transformations. This Box-Muller transform are often being used to generate normal from normal distribution. So if U1 and U2 are IID random variable from uniform 0, 1, the variable X1 and X2, this is the transformation. X1 is called square root of minus 2 times log of U1 times cos 2 U2, and X2 will be, actually here it is X2, just a minute. X2 is minus square root of minus 2 log U1 sine 2 pi U2. These X1 and X2 follow normal 0, 1. So what I have to do, I have to just simulate U1 and U2 from uniform 0, 1. And then I have to plug in U1 and U2 here and here. Then X1 and X2 will give me the simple two independent samples from normal 0, 1. Box-Muller algorithm is an exact algorithm. When I'm saying exact, that means there is exact mathematically analytical solution to simulate from the normal distribution. There are some other algorithms were developed. Remember that when I'm computing, it looks like a very simple transformation. But remember that this, I have to do this cos 2 pi U2 calculation. I have to do this log U1 calculation. And then I have to take the square root. So these are computational cost I have to bear, right? There are some alternate algorithm to simulate from normal 0,1 have been developed, which are the time complexity of which is much better than Box-Muller transformation. So Box-Muller transformation is very well-known transformations. People do know that, you know, it's a wonderful transformation in mathematically beautiful exact transformation, which gives you a sample from uniform 0, 1. But in practice, in the built-in functions, actually, they don't use those Box-Muller transformations. I mean, they have, but not at a default setup, because the Box-Muller transformation, the time complexity for the Box-Muller transformation is turns out to be higher than the other existing algorithms. So just a minute, I am getting a call. I need to. Okay. So here I simulated from U1 from again from uniform distribution and U2 from uniform distribution. And here I did a Box-Muller transformation. Simulated the Y from the built-in functions in R, and then I just did a Kolmogorov-Smirnov test, and again it shows that X and Y, X1 this and Y, they are coming from the same transformations. But these Box-Muller transformation is very specific to normal distributions. There are many, many other distributions for which we do not have mathematically closed from CDF. And that means if I have to develop this kind of transformations, which will give me exact simulation strategy, that means I have to develop this kind of transformations for each and every probability models that I'm interested in. And as the data is getting complicated, my probability models are getting complicated, this kind of transformations is almost beyond our imaginable, capability. So it's really not feasible. So what people have realized that there are many distributions where the standard transformation methods fail. For these cases, we must turn into some kind of indirect method. So we generate candidate random variables and only accept it subject to a passing test. And such class of methods are called accept-reject method or acceptance-rejection algorithm. And these algorithms are extremely powerful. If we go through the method, then you will know what exactly, why it is so powerful. So we only need a functional form of the density F. So we just only need a PDF. We don't need the CDF. As long as we know the functional form of the PDF, we are in business. So F is the target density, target probability density function from where we want to simulate. But we don't know how to simulate from F. Okay. We figure out G is a candidate density. When I'm saying candidate density, it is a similar kind of density, means it has the similar kind of support in the same regions, they overlap their support. Say, I am looking for, suppose F is a density, which is a cumbersome density. I don't know how to simulate from that distribution, but I do know the support of that density is 0 to 1. If that is so, then I can think of a candidate density could be beta distribution, because beta distribution also have a support between 0 and 1. Similarly, if I know that F is a density which takes value between 0 to infinity, the support is between, theoretical support is between 0 to infinity. Then I have 2-3 different candidate distribution. One could be log normal, one could be gamma distribution, one could be inverse gamma distribution. So there could be a lot of other distributions which I can use as a candidate density. And another criteria for candidate distribution is we know how to simulate random variable from this candidate density. So the only constraint we impose on this candidate density G is that F and G have compatible support. That is, Gx is greater than 0 when Fx is greater than 0. Okay. And X follow F can be simulated as in the following way. So generate Y from G and another variable U from uniform 0, 1. If U is less than equal to 1 by M, F of Y, G of Y, then you set X equal to Y. Otherwise, you reject Y. If inequality does not satisfy, then discard Y, you reject the Y, and you go to the loop. And you can choose, you can set M as F of X, G X, sup of, supremum of f of x gx. So one can show that probability of acceptance rate will be 1 by m. So typically the acceptance rejection algorithm will be, you generate y from the candidate density, and then you simulate from uniform 0, 1. You accept x equal to y if u is less than equal to f of y by m times g of y, and return to 1 otherwise. So you keep doing that. Question is, why does this method works? The simple probability calculation, that probability of y less than equal to x given that it accepts. Okay. Basically, that is what I'm doing. I'm just simulating y less than equal to x given that the accept, when the accept happens, that means u is less than equal to f of y by m times g of y. Okay. Now question is, can you show, and that will result into probability of x less than equal to x. Can you tell me why it is so, and or how it is so? Any idea? Think about it. You take your time.
Do you mind scrolling up to the definition of M?
Yeah, you can use M. M is here. But how I'm solving from here to here, I'm coming from here to here. Basically, I'm saying that I'm simulating from Y. I'm accepting Y as X if this condition satisfies. So that means effectively I'm computing this probability distribution. Y is less than equal to X given the accept. I'm saying this probability, conditional probability distribution is same as probability X less than equal to X. Can you prove it? Think about it. I will not give you the solution right away. Okay. It should not be very difficult. If you just put your heads on, you should be able to do it. Okay? It's not very difficult. Okay, so let's take this result, and that is why acceptance rejection algorithm is being accepted. That yes, if I take this strategy, if I use this strategy, it will give me samples of X from the target distribution F, which has a PDF of F. Okay. Okay. All right. I'm not giving you the solution. Think about it. I'm not. Okay. So, simulating from G, output of this algorithm is exactly distributed from F. So this is being accepted because of this result. Otherwise, people would have not accepted as a valid method of simulating from target distribution F. And that is also important to understand why it works, why this. So that is why I'm saying that try to solve this result. This is a result, effectively this is a result, okay? And another thing is this result is independent of dimension. Theoretically, this result method works in any dimension. It is a two dimension probability model, three dimension probability model, p dimension probability model, it doesn't matter. It will work on any dimension because it is just being proved on a distribution functions. That's it. As long as G is a density over the sample space F, as long as you know how to simulate from the G, you will be able to simulate from the F. Only you need to know F of G up to a constant and only need an upper bound for M, bound on M, that's it. So here I have given some method, examples. I have discussed some examples. Suppose I want to simulate from beta distribution AB. No direct method available if AB are not integers. So what I will do, I want to generate for A equal to 2.3, B equal to 7.9. I have just ad hoc chosen. So, okay, we can generate if AB is an integer. But so my candidate distribution, I have taken say uniform 0, 1, because I know beta distributions, the value of beta distribution that is between 0 and 1. A uniform also has the 0 and 1. So what I have done, I said, okay, let's take a simulation size of 500. First, you sample from uniform 0, 1. I create accept, just placeholder. And here is the iteration start. First, you simulate from uniform 0, 1, one sample between 0 and 1. If D unif of xi 0, 1, whatever that sample you have simulated, 3 times u is less than equal to d beta of 2.3 and 7.9, you accept, otherwise you reject. Okay. And then you keep doing, and in the sample of x, sample.x, you have the samples. So remember that this sample.x, I have simulated from uniform 0. I did not simulate from the beta distribution. I just simulated these numbers from the uniform 0, 1. Then what I did, I just evaluate. So d beta is the PDF. It will just given the value of xi, it will give the value of PDF of beta at 2.3, A equal to 2.3, B equal to 7.9. That's it. That's all it is doing. So it is just evaluating the PDF with respect to uniform 0, 1. And then either it is accepting it as a sample, representative sample from beta 2.3, 7.9, or it is rejecting it. Which, no, it is not from beta distribution 2.3, 7.9. And then I have drawn a histogram, an acceptance rate. Now, so this is the candidate density I drawn from uniform 0, 1. You can see it's like a, you know, flat, nothing doing between 0 and 1, bunch of, you know, flat.
So, in the above code, what is the value of M?
M I have taken 3. I've just, I say earlier, okay?
Okay.
Okay. One reason was actually I had some sense that, you know, when I draw the thing, the maximum value of the density can go up to three point something, and uniform is always one. So 3 by 1 is 3. So supremum will be, you can take 4 actually. So should not be any problem. 4 and 4 also. Okay. So acceptances drops a bit, but that's okay, I think. Now, what I have done is that this is the histogram of the simulated. So this is the simulated candidate density, histogram of the simulated sample from uniform 0, 1. Those samples, some of them are being accepted, some of them being rejected. I have just taken the accepted samples and draw a histogram. And here is a red line, if you can see. Let me just do it a little bit. This red little line is the actual PDF of beta 2.37.9. That's how it looks like. So it's almost similar to the same thing. And you can do a Kolmogorov-Simonov test against actual thing. I have not done that. But it looks like it is actually coming from the target density is doing reasonably well. Then what I did, instead of taking the candidate density uniform 0, 1, I have taken candidate density 1 beta 1.5, because I know how to simulate from beta 1.5. Because if the betas are integer, I can use this result. Right? I can simulate from the exponential, I can just take the sum of them and then n beta, basically. So that's why I have just taken beta 1.5. And my target is beta 2.37.9. So let me just, and when I run that. So this is my candidate density, okay? And this is the simulated numbers. So you can see that even beta 2.7 is even closer. So that also doing this. So acceptance regions, it's rejection sample algorithm is something that works really well, but the problem is we have to have a fair idea about M. And Shailendra was right, actually, his intuition is right, that how I choose M. This was a sort of a, you know, art comes in. People try different values of M and see where the acceptance rate coming in. If the acceptance rate is somewhere at around 30-40%, they think like, okay, this M looks like a reasonable choice of M. But playing a particular, and it's a one dimension problem. Remember that I'm just simulating from one dimension univariate sum distribution. But when you will have a real life problem with lots of dimension, even 3, 4, 5 dimension, at that time, discover the aim could be real pain, right? So so acceptance rejection will not work in a very high dimension. Theoretically, it will work. Theoretically, no problem. Theoretically, it will work. It should work. But implementation will become a bit of a challenge when we go to the end. But what helps me, if you can solve this probability problem, this result, that will clarify you, and that will help us to go to the next algorithm, improvement over acceptance rejection, where we don't have to rely on the M, but we will use this idea of acceptance rejection in something called important sampling. Important sampling is something very different in behavior. Okay, so we will start important sampling next day on the Monday, but important sampling is very different in strategy. but it will help us to understand why important something works. So before Monday, I will recommend you to try to solve this problem, okay? That why acceptance rejection actually works. This how this, I, this is basically my algorithm. Okay, if given the acceptance, y less than equal to x is my probability distribution. That is exactly equivalent to probability of x equal to x, x less than equal to x, the my target distribution. And how it works, I mean, how it comes from here to here.
Is this something like a Radon-Nikodym derivative?
Yes. You have to use that. I mean, I don't want to use that and Radon-Nikodym derivative, the word, but the idea you have, if you can use. I mean, you don't need that. Yeah, density.
I have a mathish back, and the form looks
understand. Right. Yes, you are right. Yes. Basically, you have a measure from, and you are projecting into another measure. Absolutely right. You are perfectly, absolutely right on the top of money. But you can prove this result without using the concept of Radon-Nikodym derivative. Just the concept of basic calculus should be able to do that. But you are absolutely 100% right. It is there. Okay. My guess, if you do a little bit of search on the Google, you will get the solution. But don't jump into the solution right away. Try to solve it, okay? Try to solve it. If you don't, that's okay. If you try, I mean, take 2-3 days, but try to solve it. It should not be a very difficult problem, okay? And then you can, for verification, once you have at least one solution, then you go and look for the solution. But don't look for the solution right away. Try to solve it, okay? It's a very few, very nice probability problem. And also it gives you the basic foundation of how Monte Carlo simulation works. Okay, so this is the algorithm and the important sampling algorithm. These two ideas, when we will club them, that will help us to develop the Markov chain Monte Carlo, okay? All right, anybody have any other question? Otherwise, it's a lunch time. We should go for lunch. No? Okay, then we will close today's class.
Yeah, just one thing.
Yeah.
I was asking about the recordings for the last one.
So the part one I have uploaded last night. Part two I will do by tonight, and as well as this one also. Okay, I'll try to do it by tonight. As I'm very sorry, I forgot completely.
No, that's absolutely fine. I also emailed you at the last minute.
Yeah. No. I'll do that. I'll do that. Tonight I'll definitely do that. Okay. Actually, I got a couple of deadlines and all these things resulted into the miss. But I'll definitely do that.
Sir, one question.